Dear learners, welcome to NIOS. I am Professor Anjali Bajpayee from Banaras Hindu University, and today we will be discussing about planning at class level, lesson plan for science, traditional approach. If we have to define a lesson plan, the definition of a lesson plan is, as per goods, outline of the important points of a lesson arranged in the order in which they are to be presented to the students by the teacher. That is one of the definition of lesson plan. Another definition of lesson plan given by Bossing is, lesson plan is the title given to a statement of the achievements to be realized and the specific means by which these are attained as a result of activities engaged during the period. So, we can say lesson plan is what? Is there what a teacher does in a class. Another definition of lesson plan can be by Laser B. Strands. It is actually a plan of action. It therefore includes the working philosophy of the teacher, his knowledge of philosophy, his information about the objectives, his understanding of his pupils, his comprehension of education, his knowledge of the material to be taught, and his abilities to utilize the effective material. So, in whole, it is what a teacher does in his class. Binning and Binning have said, daily lesson planning involves defining the objectives, selecting and arranging the subject matter, and determining the methods of the procedure. So, what we do daily in the class is a lesson plan. If we have to say what is a lesson plan, we can say through a lesson plan, the teacher regularly achieves the teaching objectives and processes in form of complex objectives and process involved in classroom. A lesson plan develops the possibilities of adjustment in the classroom situation, which makes teaching effective. Therefore, whatever a teacher does in class is what is a lesson plan. A lesson plan helps in calling every step of a curriculum, that is, we have to see what is there in curriculum is included in the lesson plan. A lesson plan helps in planning the process of teaching on basis of class control, motivation and individual difference. These happen in the real classroom situation. The lesson plan keeps the teacher to be systematic and organized in his classroom teaching. It helps him to produce the matter or the subject matter in a very systematic way. It gives confidence and self-reliance to the teacher, because if we are prepared, we know that we will be able to achieve our objective in classroom systematically and effectively. It accelerates teaching in a proper direction, because things are prior determined, and if we have the things in our order, we can always proceed in the right direction. It does not allow the teacher to deviate, because in classroom situation, the things are there where a learner may ask many new things, and if the teacher deviates in that way, then he may not be able to do justice to the topic which he is teaching. So, the lesson plan limits him to what he has to cover effectively. It assists the teacher to evaluate his teaching and thereby giving him the feedback to do better in the next time. And it saves time because things are organized in a logical manner. The basis of lesson plan is that we have to see the objectives. It is objective based. What are the objectives which have to be covered in a particular time? Decision about the material aids, what material aids have to be required for a particular lesson. It is based on previous knowledge. We have to link the new lesson with the previously learned lesson. Division of plan in unit, that a lesson can be divided into various units which can be taught separately. Simplicity of the activities which have to be covered to teach a lesson. And it also determines the activities which have to be taught during a lesson or which have to be involved during a lesson. It takes care of the homework, self-evaluation, use of illustration, use of blackboard, and gives flexibility to the teacher while planning the plan. The various approach of lesson planning are Herbertian approach, Repeat, the various approach to lesson planning are the Dalton plan, Herbertian approach, Bloom's approach, DV and Kilpatrick approach, Morrison's approach, RCEM approach, and the Socratic approach. If we deal one by one, we see that Dalton plan was developed by Helen Parcott at Dalton High School in USA, and therefore it is known as the Dalton plan. It involves the learning activities which are organized by providing monthly assignment to the pupil. Assignments are to be completed within a time period, followed by a reward given by the teacher to the pupil. The progress of each student is recorded in a card called the job card by the teacher, and then the teacher proceeds in a desired direction for every pupil. Classrooms are replaced by subject rooms where pupils get required material for the study. The role of teacher in Dalton plan. The teacher in the Dalton plan is a helper. He is a stimulator, not a dictator. His important roles are preparing assignments, which are the contracts, and giving them to the pupil when required. Keeping an atmosphere of study in the room or the classroom or the subject room, giving explanation to any details of the assignment if the student asks, ensuring that each assignment is finished properly, keeping full records of the progress of the student in the report or the card, keeping subject library and other equipments up to date, so in case the student requires any additional material, it can be given to him. The characteristics of a Dalton plan are, the curriculum is divided into units of work or assignments, which can be termed as contracts. Pupil contract to complete these assignments in a prescribed time and are at liberty to study with different subjects how and when they please. The progress of work is recorded by the teacher in form of graphs. The subject room replaces the classroom where the student works as and when he chooses. In the Dalton plan, the class teacher as such plays a less prominent part than before, while the importance of reference books is greater. Therefore, there has to be a very rich library for a Dalton plan. The next approach is the Herbertian approach, which deals with preparation for a particular topic, presentation of that topic, comparison and association of the concept taught, generalization, that is implementing the concept in wider situation, and application and repetition. Whenever required, the things have to be used and they have to be repeated in day-to-day situations. In presentation, lesson is developed involving pupil as active participants, using questioning and other aids to make the lesson more interesting and comprehensive, following heuristic attitude and the people get some new ideas. In comparison and association, the facts are compared, observed by the student with another concept by way of giving examples to make them think in an innovative manner. By this way, student can derive theories and also develop new insight. Generalization is arriving at some general ideas or conclusions by the students on the basis of the different comparisons and association observed in the learning material. Application and repetition deals with the teacher makes the student to use the understood knowledge in an unfamiliar new situation. And reviewing a lesson by giving assignments, the teacher knows whether the student has grasped the lesson and he can also evaluate if he was able to present the lesson in an effective way. Bloom's taxonomy or Bloom's approach is also known as the evaluative approach. Triplural process it involves formulation of educational objectives, providing the learning experience, and evaluating the learning outcomes. In a graphical or a tabular form, it can be represented in the following way. That is, first we have to deal with the teaching point, then we have to write the instructional objectives, Then we have to discuss the teacher's activity, then the student activities, deciding what the method of teaching has to be, and finally how it has to be evaluated. TV and Kilpatrick approach deals with planning, creation of conditions, developing a blueprint, implementation of planning, and recording of work and observation. Morrison's approach is also known as the unit approach. What it deals with, it takes a related set of lessons in a combined form, that is a unit. The unit presentation deals with exploration, presentation, assimilation, organization, and recitation. That is, first we have to explore a unit, then we have to present it systematically, then we have to see that the related concepts or the topics are linked to each other and presented in a assimilated manner. The organization has to be very systematic, and repetition of things has to be done so that the student understand the related things properly. Next is the RCEM approach, which deals with input, process, and output. Input deals with expected behavioral outcomes, that is EBOS. Process deals with communication strategy, and output deals with real learning outcomes, which can be written as RLOS. These aspects resemble the introduction, presentation, and evaluation phase of a traditional lesson plan. The Socratic method or approach. The Socratic method, can also be known as eclectic method or Socratic debate, is a form of cooperative argumentative dialogue between individual based on asking and answering question to stimulate critical thinking and to draw out ideas and underline presumptions. It is a dialectical method involving a discussion in which the defense of one point of view is questioned. One participant may lead another to contradict themselves in some way, thus weakening the defender's point. This method is named after the classical Greek philosopher Socrates, and it was introduced by him in Plato's Theaetetus. The Socratic method is a method of hypothesis elimination, is that better hypotheses are found by steadily identifying and eliminating those that lead to contradiction. Socratic method searches for general commonly held truths that shape belief and scrutinize them to determine their consistency with other beliefs. The basic form is a series of questions formulated as tests of logic and fact intended to help a person or group to discover their beliefs about some topic, exploring definitions or logics and seeking to characterize general characteristics shared by various particular instances. Example of Socratic method are, Socrates' opponents asserted that a hypothesis, for example, courage is endurance of the soul, which Socrates considers false and targets for its refutation. Socrates secured his opponent's agreement to further premises, for example, courage is a fine thing and ignorant endurance is not a fine thing. Socrates then argues, and the opponent agrees, that these further premises imply that contrary of the original hypothesis, in this case it leads to courage is not endurance of the soul. Therefore, in Socratic debate, one hypothesis can be replaced by other hypothesis by mutual argumentation and discussion, and thereby developing a lesson in a very interactive way. Socrates then claims that has shown that his opponent's hypothesis is false and that its negation is true. One cross-examination can lead to a new, more refined examination of the concept being considered. In this case, it invites an examination of the claim, courage is wise endurance of the soul. Therefore, the whole hypothesis is revised. For a traditional lesson plan, we have to put certain things in mind. For example, we have to put the number of the lesson plan, the name of the school where the lesson has to be taught, the date on which day the lesson has to be taught, the class to which the lesson has to be taught, the subject for which the plan is being made, the period in which that lesson is being taught, and the duration in which that lesson has been taught. The duration may vary from 30 to 40 to 50 depending upon school to school. And finally, the topic which has to be taught in that particular lesson. This topic is not a whole chapter. It is that part of the chapter that will be taught in that 30, 40 or 50 minutes. Then the objectives have to be written. First of all, we have to write the general objectives of science and then the specific objectives in various levels. The specific objectives can be 2 to 6 in number. They have to be of knowledge level, of understanding level, and of application level. At least we should try and reach in each lesson to the application level objective if possible. Then the previous knowledge has to be presented because that is the basis on which the new lesson has to be learnt. The introduction has to be divided into student teacher's activity or the teacher's activity and the student activity. The question based on previous knowledge have to be presented. The number of questions should not be large. It can be 1 to 5. The tentative answers to be given by the students are recorded so that it helps us to frame the next question. And on the basis of last question, we should come to our topic which we are going to teach. It is not necessary that the student should answer the topic, then only we can start the topic. If the student is able to reach near the topic, we can just give our statement of aim that today we are going to discuss about this particular topic. For example, if we have asked the parts of a plant and we have to teach the root system, and if the student answers the underground part of a plant is a root, we can give our statement of aim from there that today we are going to discuss about the root system of a plant. Main presentation of the lesson has to be organized in various columns. That is what teaching points, that is the main points which are to be covered in a lesson. For example, if we are going to teach root system, then the main subtopics or the teaching points should be function of the roots, type of roots, structure of roots. Those should be the teaching points. On this, the various activities of the student teacher have to be formed, like they can give statements, they can ask questions, and these statements and questions have to be written. What tentative activities of the students will be there, they also should be written in the lesson plan because they help us to frame the next step of the teacher's activity in a proper manner. And in last column, we should also write what are the teaching aids or explanatory devices or the analysis which we will be doing during that particular topic. Similarly, each topic has to be developed in the form of subtopics. Finally, at the end of presentation, we should have summary of all the topics. This summary should be summarized in form of words, in form of a few statements, and it should also be presented in the blackboard point-wise. Everything should not be written point-wise. Hierarchical, conceptual diagrams or graphical representations, concept maps should be used to draw the blackboard summary so that important points of a lesson are presented systematically on the blackboard while summarizing the lesson. Finally, we have to give few evaluative questions based on our specific objectives to see whether we have obtained the purpose of the lesson, and the lesson should always end with the assignment of 1 or 2 questions which the student should do at the end, and these assignments should be properly checked or at least talked about by the teacher in the next class. So, a lesson plan is a comprehensive design which helps the teacher to come prepared to his class, and a science lesson plan should be very systematically organized in these steps so that the lesson can be interesting and effective. Thank you.